I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Good morning, middle school. Hope you're all doing well. It is great to connect with you through this chapel. I have a few announcements. This is a very important week. On Wednesday and Thursday, we have our parent-teacher conferences. And parents, if you haven't signed up for a conference with your child's teacher, please do so before 3 p.m. on Tuesday. Conferences will be Wednesday and Thursday. Wednesday's conference will begin at 10:30 and end at 7 o'clock, and Thursday's conferences will be from 8 a.m. until 3 p.m. And then Friday is a big day. We will have our middle school adventure day from 9:30 until 2:30 at the Indian Springs Day Camp in Chester Springs. So looking forward to seeing all of you there. Drop-off time is 9:15. Indian Springs Day Camp is a 40-acre campsite, and so we can socially distance and maintain all the safety protocols while we have fun during our middle school adventure day. And then next Monday will be our return to on-campus learning, and you will receive the schedule from me for that week and following weeks. We are calling that hybrid learning. So we are moving from remote learning into hybrid learning, and you will receive the schedule for hybrid learning from me later this week. All right, this morning, it is my privilege to introduce our chapel speaker, Mr. Cocco. Mr. Cocco is our Director of Enrollment Management, and he is, for those of you who have met him fairly recently, he is probably one of the first faces you would encounter when you come to visit Montgomery School. He gets to tell you all the wonderful things about Montgomery School, so you can get a sense of this wonderful environment that you'll be entering in. And he's also an amazing leader, and I've seen him interact with middle school students when he conducted meetings with the student ambassadors. It's just almost like students look at him and they just can't stop listening to him. Mr. Cocco is also father of two children. His older daughter, Ava, is a student at Montgomery and she's in pre-K. One of the things that I personally envy about Mr. Cocco is his ability to do home improvement projects, which I have no skill at. He can probably have his own home improvement show on television. Recently, he built a full-size dining table basically from scratch. And that's the kind of skills he has outside of being an amazing leader here at Montgomery School. So this morning, please join me in welcoming Mr. Cocco to the stage.
Thank you so much for that warm introduction, Mr. Raj. It was really heartfelt, and I really appreciated it. Hi, middle schoolers. I want to talk to you today a little bit about kites and clotheslines. And that probably doesn't make a lot of sense right now, but as we go, hopefully you'll take some good life lessons away from me telling a couple of stories today. So, first, I want to tell you a little story about two crazy kids. One's a kite, and the other one's a clothesline. So once upon a time, which is how all the best stories start, there was a girl named Ashley and a boy named Drew. And as you can tell from the pictures, Ashley had a tendency to be pretty silly, kind of spontaneous, very much go with the flow, off the cuff. And Drew tended to be a little more serious, a little more planned out, a little more structured, grounded, some might say, boring, others might say. Not as exciting, not as spontaneous. But one day, Ashley and Drew met, and they became really good friends. And then, after a while, they started dating. And the longer they dated, and the more they got to know each other, the more they got to understand who they were, both in and of themselves, but also to each other. And it became incredibly apparent that in this case, opposites attract. See, in this case, Ashley was the kite, and Drew was the clothesline. If you haven't figured it out by now, Ashley is my wife, and I'm the Drew that we're talking about here. I had a tendency to want to plan everything from the minute I woke up to the minute I went to bed. Ashley had a tendency to want to just figure it out as we went. And the perfect example was kind of how we were raised. So Ashley grew up with a family that was very loose, very go with the flow. They would not plan a vacation, they would just take a vacation. And they'd decide to drive up to Wisconsin and not have any hotels booked ahead of time, and instead just sort of look for whatever was open while they were already up there. My family, well, we would plan a trip to King of Prussia Mall, and I'm not even being facetious. We literally would plan a week in advance if we were going to go to King of Prussia Mall the next weekend. So that was what I grew up with. But the more I hung out with Ashley and the more I hung out with her family, the more I got to loosen up a little bit. In fact, in college, a couple of my friends would sometimes describe me as a clenched fist. Very, very rigid. But I started to loosen up a little bit. And at the same time, Ashley started to start planning things more and more. In fact, she actually got a student planner. Actually, she was always very organized in school. It was more of in her personal life. But she started to see different ways of doing things. But I think the one who benefited the most was me. I definitely learned how to become an unclenched fist. And then, after a while, we got engaged, and we got married. And another perfect example of Mrs. Cocco, Ashley, is the fact that she wore pink Chucks at our wedding. Pink Chuck Taylors. I never would have even considered wearing sneakers at my wedding, but Ashley wore her pink Chucks. Another great example is a story that I actually told the Montgomery community last year. 1 year after we were married, I think it was our first fall, we were watching Man vs. Food. And if anybody remembers that show, it was a guy named Adam who would go out and he would do these different food challenges all over the country. And one of the food challenges he did was the wing challenge up in Buffalo, New York. That's where Buffalo Wings got their name. He went to the two most famous wing joints up there, Duff's and Anchor Bar. And he wanted to see kind of who had the best wings and could he eat Duff's Insanity super, super duper hot wings that were made with ghost pepper extract and all sorts of crazy stuff. And we're watching this program, and at the end, Mrs. Cocco turns to me and she says, "I really want wings now." I said, "Okay, great. Yeah, you know what? I do too. I'm totally in the mood for wings." And I said, I'll just call up the local pizza place and we'll order some wings. And she goes, no. I want those wings. And I was like, "Sweetie, those wings are in Buffalo. That's 6.5 hours away." And she's like, "Yeah, so?" And in a classic kite clothesline moment, I said, "So, nobody just drives 6.5 hours to go get wings without planning something first." And Ashley said, "We could be those people." And we did. We jumped in the car, we packed an overnight bag, and we drove to Buffalo. We got a hotel while we were up there, crashed the night, spent the day at Niagara Falls, and then we went and we hit up those two wing places. I actually did eat almost all of the plate of the super hot Insanity Death Wings when the waitress brought them to me, sidebar. She was wearing gloves and a mask, and they were covered, and she dropped them in front of me, took the cover off, and went, "Good luck." And it was a rough night. But we got up the next day, ate some more wings, and went home. And the reason that I tell you this story is because when we got married, the priest who married us, when he gave his homily, said, that Ashley is a kite and Drew is a clothesline. That's just who we are. And we can change a little bit and you know, we'll help each other out. But his whole point was that if I was left to my own devices, like a clothesline unattached, I would just sort of be really boring and sitting on the ground. Likewise, Ashley as the kite, if she was untethered, she would just sort of fly away, go wherever the wind was blowing her. And our real strength was in who we were for each other. She was the kite that, tied to my clothesline, would lift me up off the ground. But me, as the clothesline, would still be able to keep her tethered and centered in one place. And that was how we grew together, and we have continued to grow together. And we have a lovely family and two beautiful children. Ava's 4, and she's in pre-K here. My son Harrison is 2.5. I think Harrison's taking actually a little bit more after Ashley, and Ava might be taking a little more after me in terms of personality, but it's so cool to see both of who we are in them, and I'm so excited to find out who they are. And so my question that I want all of you to ponder today is, who are you? How well do you know yourself? Temet noske. Know thyself. It is one of the 3 Greek maxims on the Apollo temple back in ancient Greece. And there were 3 entrance maxims, and this was the first one. Know thyself. So ask yourself this question. Do you know yourself? How do you get to know yourself? To an extent, I'm a clothesline, but I'm so many other things as well. Who are you when you're by yourself versus who are you with your family? Are you a kite in your family or are you a clothesline in your family? Who are you with your friends? Are you the clothesline of the friends group? No, we can't, you know, do all of these XYZ things. We haven't really thought things through. Or are you the kite in your group of friends saying, let's just go, or somewhere in between? The more you think about who you are in different settings, with different places, with different people, the more you start to understand yourself. And the more you understand yourself, the more you can grow. It's kind of like that scene from Moana, if you remember that.
Why do you hesitate?
I don't know.
I know a girl from an island. She stands apart from the crowd. She loves the sea and her people. She makes her whole family proud. Sometimes the world seems against you. The journey may leave a scar, but scars can heal and reveal just where you are. The people you love will change you. The things you have learned will guide you, and nothing on earth can silence the quiet voice still inside you. And when that voice starts to whisper, Moana, you've come so far. Moana, listen, do you know who you are?
So one of the reasons I love that scene is because it speaks to the journey that is self-discovery, that is towards that ultimate goal of knowing thyself. When Moana's grandmother says, the people that love you will change you. The things that you do in life will guide you. It speaks to the fact that knowing yourself isn't a static thing. It's a process. And the answer to that question will change as you get older, as you grow, as you meet more people, as they change you. And so it's a constant, lifelong process of self-discovery and rediscovery. And it's a big part of what makes life beautiful. It's the central question for so many of us, and especially you guys as middle schoolers. as you are in a transition, as you are growing up, as you're sort of leaving that elementary school stage of your life and moving towards high school and beyond, that question of who am I? I'm sure it's on your mind, as it is for all of us, pretty constantly, and trying to figure that out and trying to sort of gather experiences and gather people and sort of see how others shape us, but also how we can shape ourselves. Moana had one vision of herself at the beginning of the film and a completely different vision of who she was at the end of the film. Similarly, her dad had one very particular idea of who she was at the beginning of the film and a completely different picture of who she was at the end of the film. And so, knowing thyself is also understanding the context and how other people see us as well and who they know us to be. And so my suggestion to you is to take some time to reflect, take some time to be introspective and think about, who am I? Why do I do the things that I do? Why do I say the things that I say? Why do I not do certain things? Why do I not say certain things? And my advice to you would be to never be afraid to be yourself. Never be afraid to be who you are. Because as that changes and grows, the more authentic you can be with yourself will allow you to be authentic with everyone else. Thank you so much.